very much the organizers for the invitation. I'm very pleased to contribute to the meeting, even remotely. We will discuss parathyroid ultrasound. The learning objectives would be to know how to pose the right indication for imaging the thyroids, the parathyroids, to optimize the ultrasound settings to look for parathyroid lesions, to recognize them based on their location, their appearance, and their vascularity, and to be aware of certain challenges with parathyroid ultrasound. I will not stay long on the concepts of primary hyperparathyroidism. The epidemiology and the clinical characteristics that you can see here, often today it is diagnosed in asymptomatic stages. I think for you, the important thing to retain is that it is almost always a benign disease and not associated with cancer, parathyroid carcinomas being very rare. Diagnosis is biochemical, and basically there is a high level of parathyroid hormone that is, or a level that is inappropriate for the level of calcium. This comes in different flavors, both can be high. Calcium can be high in PTH unsuppressed, so in the reference range when it should be undetectable or very low. Or normal calcium with high PTH, what's called normal calcemic primary hyperparathyroidism. There are certain other causes of hyperparathyroidism that need to be excluded, secondary causes, before confirming primary hyperpara. And another rare disease, familial hypercalcemic hypocalciuria, that needs to be excluded based on how the kidney handles calcium. As I said, cancer is very rare in this setting, and almost always it's a benign disease. 85% of the time there is a single thyroid, a parathyroid adenoma that is hyperfunctional. And in 10 to 15% of cases, there are several glands that are hyperfunctioning, either with independent adenomas, double adenomas, or with a hyperplasia, diffuse or nodular of the glands. And this can be often in the case of multiple endocrine neoplasia syndromes. So to come back to our learning objectives, when do you think one should perform imaging of the parathyroids? Should it be done as part of the workup to confirm the diagnosis of primary hyperpara? After the diagnosis, to decide whether surgery should be done, or after the decision to operate to guide the surgeon? I'll let you take 2 seconds to reflect. So the answer is that it is part of the pre-surgical workup. The diagnosis itself is purely biochemical. The decision to operate or not after confirming the diagnosis is based on the presence of symptoms, notably kidney disease, kidney stones, or biochemical criteria for those patients that don't have kidney stones, and not on the results of imaging. This is important to realize. So whether one sees an adenoma or not, if one is sure about the diagnosis and the patient should have surgery based on these criteria, the patient should go for surgery, a neck exploration in that case. If one visualizes an adenoma, this does not mean that the patient should have surgery. So the criteria are not dependent on the localization of the lesion. So imaging of the parathyroid should be done only when both the following conditions are met. Primary hyperpara has been diagnosed and the decision has been made to operate the patient. We mentioned there are specific indications for surgery. It's worth it to just be aware of them. One is when there are symptoms, notably kidney stones. And in those cases that there are no symptoms, the criteria are the following. An age below 50 years, a calcium that is above a certain threshold, the presence of radiological osteoporosis or clinical osteoporosis, and renal insufficiency or a very high excretion of calcium in the urine, or the presence of kidney stones or of nephrocalcinosis, a diffuse calcification of the kidney based on imaging. So in those cases, patients will go for surgery, and in those cases, it is indicated to imaging of the parathyroids, because if the lesion or lesions are localized, this facilitates a minimally invasive parathyroidectomy, a targeted intervention in which there is a unilateral targeted excision of the adenoma, with intraoperative monitoring of parathyroid hormone levels, which would fall rapidly when the adenoma is removed. And this confirms that the operation was successful. So this leads to a shorter operation with fewer complications in terms of damaging benign the other normal glands or the recurrent laryngeal nerve. But this requires accurate preoperative localization, and it may miss a multiglandular disease, as we will see. In discussing the place of ultrasound in the preoperative imaging of parathyroids, it is important to be aware of the other imaging modalities for this indication. So we will go very quickly through each of them. Technetium 99 SESTAM-EB, normally today with SPECT-CT imaging, has the advantage of having a very high positive predictive value for solitary adenomas. It can also detect ectopic glands outside the neck, where the, for example, in the mediastinum, where the ultrasound has no access. It is less accurate for double adenomas or hyperplasia, and the uptake of the tracer depends on the main type of cells in the adenoma. Chief cells have a poorer uptake, and this means that there will always be systemic negative scans because of the type of cells that are in the adenoma. It is an exam that uses ionizing radiation. It's more expensive than ultrasound. A new imaging modality is PET with 18 fluorocholine. It is very sensitive. The indications are still evolving. In our center, we use it when the systemic scan is negative or unclear, or discordant with the ultrasound imaging. This is the appearance of a left inferior adenoma on a choline PET. And this is an intrathymic ectopic adenoma that is obviously inaccessible to ultrasound imaging. And it is the disadvantage of the exam is that it gives a false positive because lymph nodes can take up the tracer and it still costs quite a lot. I will skip the 4DCT. I leave it here for your information. It's an exam that is used only in a few centers. It delivers quite a high radiation to the thyroid. So the advantages of ultrasound of the parathyroids is that it can be performed on-site during an outpatient consultation more quickly than other modalities, low cost, no radiation, high specificity. So if you find something that looks like a parathyroid, it is a parathyroid, probably. You evaluate the thyroid at the same time, and thyroid pathology is present in a third to half of the patients, and this can change the type of surgery that the patient has if they need treatment for thyroid disease, thyroid nodules, for example, at the same time. It also helps to interpret the findings of nuclear medicine imaging, for example, SESTAM-EB, because thyroid nodules and also intrathyroidal parathyroid adenomas can also fix SESTAM-EB. It can guide FNA if necessary, we will discuss this, and in principle, it can be done also in the operating room to help the surgeon localize the parathyroid. There are also disadvantages and limitations to parathyroid ultrasound, and notably the variable sensitivity, in general 70 to 80%, but much less than that for multiglandular disease, because primarily it depends a lot on the experience of the operator. It can also be impacted by the body type of the patient. Parathyroid glands are found deeply in the neck often, so in obese patients with a thick neck, they are more difficult to localize. It can be impacted by the size and the form of the adenoma, and if the adenoma is in a location that's not accessible, it will not be visualized. Normal parathyroid glands, most of us have four in our neck, two on each side. Some of us have fewer, some of us may have more than four. This is important when looking for ectopic parathyroid adenomas because supernumerary glands tend to be ectopic. The shape is usually ovoid, less frequently elongated or multilobular. This is their size. It rarely exceeds 1 centimeter. This is their weight. It's good to know that the superior glands are smaller than the inferior ones. And in any case, the normal parathyroid glands are rarely detectable by ultrasound. They are enveloped in a fibrofatty capsule And this capsule becomes compressed when the parathyroid grows and becomes an adenoma. And this compressed capsule becomes visible as a hyperechoic line between the adenoma and the thyroid. And this is what we can see here in a longitudinal view behind the right thyroid lobe. There is an adenoma, parathyroid adenoma, and this is the white line, the compressed capsule between the adenoma and the thyroid lobe. We will discuss now the ultrasound characteristics of parathyroid adenomas. And the first one is that most of the time, but not always, they are outside the thyroid. Most of them are adjacent to the posterior thyroid surface, as the one we saw. And often there is this indentation of the posterior thyroid capsule and the hyperechoic line that we just discussed. Intrathyroidal localization of parathyroid adenomas is more likely when there are multiple lesions. Usually adenomas are hypoechoic and homogeneous, like this one. But there are many exceptions. They can be heterogeneous, there can be isoechoic foci, there can be a cystic component. And I'll show you here an example of a 5 cm isoechoic parathyroid adenoma that I personally mistook for a thyroid nodule. Cestamibi and Colin Pett were both indicative of a parathyroid adenoma, and this was confirmed on pathology. This is an intrathyroidal parathyroid adenoma, in part hypoechoic, in part isoechoic. This is the board of the thyroid, and this is a coexisting thyroid nodule that was benign. So the surgeon, in this case, he just slit a little bit the capsule of the thyroid anteriorly, and the adenoma came out without needing to take out the thyroid lobe. We mentioned that normal glands are usually ovoid. Adenomas have highly variable shapes. They can be ovoid, they can be elongated, they can be triangular, they can be irregular, like this one, they can be round, because the adenoma tends to conform to pressures from adjacent tissues. So the shapes are very variable. The vascularity is an important aspect. Usually there is one vessel that brings blood to the adenoma. It's called the polar vessel. But there are other patterns, like a diffuse pattern, a complex pattern like an arch, or a scant pattern, an adenoma without vascularization or very little vascularization. So those were the characteristics of adenomas, and here I show you another parathyroid lesion, a parathyroid cyst. This is very rare, mostly involves the inferior gland, and this is not associated with primary hyperparathyroidism. There is a parathyroid hormone in the liquid. It can be measured in fine needle aspiration biopsy, a washout of the needle, but it's not secreted in the circulation, so it does not cause disease. Parathyroid carcinoma is usually diagnosed on clinical criteria rather than on imaging criteria. One should suspect it when the parathyroid hormone levels are very high or when the patient is rapidly developing a serious hypercalcemia. There may be or may not be a firm palpable mass depending on the location of the tumor. Confirmation is possible only on pathology. And it is based on the presence of invasion of surrounding tissues, so one should be, or vessels. So one should be aware of diagnosis of atypical adenomas, which sometimes turn out to be carcinomas clinically later, and of incomplete resections of adenomas. Possible ultrasonographic features are a bigger size than adenomas, calcifications, cystic changes, a lack of distinctive planes between the mass and the thyroid, like here, irregular margins or infiltrative margins, and infiltration of adjacent tissues, including notably the thyroid or the muscles. It is important to be aware that even though carcinomas are rare, they exist. Personally, I saw 2 in the last year, and it is important because parathyroid carcinomas require more extensive surgery than parathyroid adenomas. So they are not candidates for targeted minimally invasive surgery, but they should be subjected, if possible, to parathyroidectomy and block with ipsilateral thyroid lobectomy and a central neck dissection aiming for R0 margins. Otherwise, there's a very high risk that there will be local residual and then recurrent disease. So how should one scan the neck looking for parathyroid adenomas or other parathyroid lesions? One should start with a thyroid ultrasound, look for thyroid nodules, evaluate them for LMA, this was discussed. And this helps to interpret the findings of systemic scan or other imaging that may be done for the parathyroid lesions later. It also allows to look for intrathyroidal parathyroid adenomas like the one I showed you. One should scan the neck from the carotid arteries to the midline, so the central neck, bilaterally, from the carotid artery bifurcation superiorly to the thoracic inlet inferiorly. So this would be compartments 6 and 7, the central neck. First, one should look for adenomas at the most common positions and then at the more uncommon positions. So it's important to know which those are. And this schematic shows the common and less common positions for superior and inferior parathyroid adenomas. And the usual locations are behind the thyroid, in the tracheoesophageal groove, so between the trachea and the esophagus. And to see in this area, one asks the patient to turn the head to the right to better expose it. And below the thyroid, in the ligament between the thyroid and the thymus, the thyrothymic ligament. And there are more unusual locations, and you have a list of them here. Some of them are inaccessible to ultrasound, such as the retropharyngeal location or the retrotracheal location. But some of them are visible, such as the carotid sheath, the carotid bifurcation, and intrathyroid locations. If you want to know why the parathyroid lesions are in these locations, I'll let you consult this slide later at your own time. In terms of practical aspect, when scanning the patient's neck, it is very important to put the neck as much extended as possible with a pillow under the shoulders and to turn the patient's head away from the side that you're scanning to bring the lesions more anteriorly, more to close to the surface. The settings of the machine are very important. We should set the appropriate depth. We're looking for lesions that are usually deep. Position the focal points more deeply and favor penetration, for example, by decreasing the frequency, and by optimizing the gain in deeper positions. One should practice some voyeurism, inclining the probe towards the mediastinum, asking the patients to swallow to see if glands or lesions in the thyrothymic ligament come up and become visible during this maneuver, and so on. And how can one practice? One can practice very well with patients that are undergoing dialysis. They have secondary and sometimes tertiary hyperparathyroidism. And so they have enlarged the glands that can be easily detected by ultrasound. Here are a couple of instructive cases. This is a patient with an adenoma on the right side next to the upper pole of the right thyroid lobe. Here's the adenoma. And here's the adenoma a little bit higher. This is right next to the right thyroid cartilage. And the same patient had an adenoma on the left side, close to the carotid bifurcation here. So the lesson from this is that one does not stop the exam when one has found one adenoma, because as we mentioned at the beginning, there can be a disease of multiple glands. Very high-frequency probes that we have today, they give excellent resolution superficially, but not very good penetration. So this lesion was better visualized with a conventional probe of 12 megahertz. How about FNA? Usually we don't do FNA of parathyroid lesions because there is a risk of disseminating adenoma cells locally with recurrence of hyperparathyroidism that is incurable afterwards because there is not a single lesion, but what's called a parathyromatosis, a dispersion of cells in the neck. But if necessary, it can be done. Cytology is usually non-informative, and measurement of parathyroid in the needle washout is what is diagnostic, because then the levels will be very high, in the hundreds of thousands. This may be useful when there is a cyst with a clear aspirate, parathyroid cysts. Here we mentioned that they do not cause hyperpara. So if you're biopsying a cyst in the neck and the aspirate is clear, put it in a tube and measure parathyroid hormone. For adenomas, it can be useful when the localization is atypical, and for example, if it's intrathyroidal and it may be a thyroid nodule, in cases of reoperation after failed parathyroidectomy, in case of negative or inconclusive parathyroid imaging studies, in short, when we need to be sure if it's parathyroid or something else. And this is an example of such a case, a lesion that I was pretty sure it was a parathyroid gland. You can see it behind the thyroid, the lower pole of the thyroid on the left side. Biopsy was negative for everything, thyroid markers and parathyroid markers. It was positive on cystamibi and protecnetate. And ultimately, it was a schwannoma. It was shown on TrueCut biopsy. So not every retrothyroidal lesion will be a parathyroid adenoma, even if it looks like one, on ultrasound or on nuclear medicine imaging. My take-home messages would be that parathyroid ultrasound is a challenging but very useful imaging modality, indicated for the pre-surgical localization of parathyroid lesions. Almost all of them are benign. Indications for final aspiration of parathyroids are very limited, and carcinomas are very rare, but they require a high degree of clinical suspicion to guide the correct surgical approach. Thank you very much.